Alright, good evening one and all. In this video, I would be teaching you how to get return a value from a function when threading is done. So basically what I'm trying to say is whenever you do threading, how to get values from that function. So we are going to learn about that using queues. Okay, so let's get started. So for this example, I'm going to import a couple of libraries first. It's going to be a little long, but it's going to be very, very informative. So kindly do watch till the end. Okay. So first of all, we import time and threading. Okay, I'm gonna say accept exceptions as E. Okay, so now what I'm gonna do is basically let's define a function, right? Or let's say it takes a number, right? Let's say print. And what I'll do is basically I'm gonna use threading to do that. And let's sleep for 3 seconds and then let's basically return the square of the number. Okay, now that's done, guys. It's beautiful, right? Now if I want to show you some nice concept here, so if underscore name is equal to dunder main. Okay, if I have this stuff, right? So if I call this function, guys, in normal programming, right? Let's say you have some code here, some more code. Okay, now what happens is basically when you run this program normally, this is a synchronous programming, right? Like what happens is basically, I forgot to actually pass a number. Let's actually pass some number here, right? And when I pass it, it's a synchronous programming. It's gonna execute the function and then it's gonna do that. Now, let me show you the better way of doing this, of course. So you can say like threading, you can call a thread, you can say, you can pass a target. Target is gonna be the name of the function. And in that case, it's just gonna be this. And the arguments is basically, we're gonna pass some arguments. So arguments are a tuple always, you know that. So now if I start this thread here, so I'm gonna just say, so this means it's gonna run simultaneously both the code or parallel or concurrently. So working on it, some more code. And after a while, this code was finished execution, but I don't get the value from this function. How the hell do I get that? So for that, there is something called as queue. So we use something called as queue. Let me show you the nice concept of that. So I'm gonna basically create my queue. In Python, queue is a built-in thing, but we are software engineers. We should learn or we should know how to create a queue. Queue is something, but nothing but in which order is maintained. So the whatever goes first comes out first. So what basically, let me create a very simple queue. It's gonna take me a few seconds to write the code actually, because I'm pretty fast at coding. Okay, so we have a method called as enqueue. Basically, it's gonna take an item and we'll just say self.item. So it's a queue, right? So we have to say insert 0, right? And basically, we should just return a boolean value here. Okay, now I should have a value called as size. So it's gonna basically tell the size of the queue, right? So all I'm gonna say is return length of self.item. And I'm gonna say is empty. Basically what is empty will do is, guys, basically it's gonna check if the queue is empty. If self.size is equal to 0, return. So it's an empty, so true, else return false. So that's done, size, empty, and queue. Now we need to do a dequeue. Okay, so basically dequeue is basically we need to remove item, right? So first of all, we need to check whether self.item, or we can say self.size, is equal to 0, return none. Else basically I'm gonna say return self.item, right? Done. So that's done. So we have enqueue, we have dequeue, we have isEmpty method, which is gonna check whether the queue is empty or not. Now, just let me just define one more thing here. Let me just do an operator overloading for the print statement. Define wrapper. And also, I'm gonna say string overloading. Okay, so my Q class is ready. Okay, so now I'm gonna show you the true power of Python programming. Okay, so people who say Python is slow, guys, you don't know. I mean, it's all about threading and all of that, how you use it. So let's say Q. So what I'm gonna do is basically whenever instead of this return statement, so this was my normal execution flow, right, of my program. So I'm gonna define a class here. So remember, the Q is a global, right? It's a global. I've defined it as a global. So what I'm gonna do is basically I'm gonna create a queue, and I'm gonna create a queue outside this program because it's a global, so it can be accessed inside any function or some stuff like that. So what I'll do here is basically instead of returning stuff, whenever it's done, so I'm gonna say queue dot, I'm gonna say nq, and I'm gonna return the result here, num. And what I'll do is I'll return the statement because I'm writing an async program now, right? So what I'll do is basically as soon as you start the program, let's say this is where you need the value of that function, right? So you have to wait here. So what we'll do is basically I'm gonna show you two logic. First is the using basically coding logic. Basically, we'll just use a while true. What we'll do is basically we'll create a flag. And basically we'll say q dot, and remember we have a method called as is empty. It returns a boolean, right? So what we should do is basically if the flag pass else, now I'll tell you what the logic is. So this means that if the flag is true, that means the queue is empty, there is no data, we want to wait there. So keep waiting until you get the data, like the processing is done, right? We can say Q, once the processing is done, the flag will be false. It will be else statement, and we can say deq. So we have a method called as deq. So it's going to return the value, and we should break the loop, right? This is the one of the method that we can do. This is an easy method, of course, that I'm going to show you. All right, we have a small issue. So Q instance, we have it right here. We have a problem, and it says indentation, uni-indent does not match any indentation level. I messed up at the indentation, I suppose. Oh yeah, you're right. Let me make sure. Okay, looks good. Hopefully the indentation was fixed. Now see what happened, guys. Some more code working on it. Some more code and 1098, it computed the square. So this function right here, what we did is basically it's returning the value from a threaded function. Okay, let me repeat it again, guys. Threading, we started a thread and then we have a normal code. And this is where line 54, I want my code to wait for the value from that function. But there was a threaded function. So in order to get the value, you would enqueue it into a queue. And basically you can use this algorithm here, or this line, which basically will wait until you have any value in the queue. Another thing you could have done, instead of even doing that, I could have said T, and you could have done a join method here. The join means that the process execution of that thread was complete. And then once it's complete, you know that you can just say NQ, or you can just say Q, deq. So you will do that. Check this out, works the same. Some more code, now return the same value. All right, you see how powerful threading are, and if it's used properly, you can achieve really very great concurrency. Let's say you wanna do some processing at the same time on data frames. Use threading, man. Launch several threads at the same time, so all the data frame would be processed at the same time. So, hope you have enjoyed this tutorial. So this is how you would return a value from a function in threading. The snippets are there on the description, so check it out. And if you have questions, list your questions and would be very happy to assist you. Once again, guys, keep smiling, keep coding, keep learning something new, and I would see you next time.